Good morning.
Good morning.
And the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you very much. This is Homecoming Sunday, so welcome home. It's good to look out and see you here. You'll see that this side of the sanctuary is a little more sparse than this side. Not sure why, but as new people come in, we can direct them to this side. In addition to this being Homecoming Sunday, this is the day that Lorna brings to church her new friend, her new knee. She had it replaced, and this is her first Sunday back, so welcome, Lorna. I know that Richie had his knee replaced recently, so maybe during coffee time we can see who can run faster with their new knees. So we gather here once again. Another year passes. A new church year, shall we say, begins. My, how time flies. If only winter went as fast as summer, I'd be much happier. Now, it is the beginning, Al told me, of football season today, so I can assure you we'll be out in plenty of time for you to see the Patriots. When I was pastor in the Midwest, we were on Central Time, so games started at noon. So there was added pressure to keep things moving in order for people to get out of the sanctuary and home to see either their beloved Green Bay Packers or Chicago Bears. We don't have that problem, so we can really stretch this out today. We won't, but God is with us, and that's what's really important. We can settle into this time a different hour from the rest of the week, where in a special way we direct our attention to God, and then we go out with good intentions to be God's people in the world. So let's prepare now for worship with the prelude. Gives us hope. So let's pray. O God of hope, who takes us from the cradle of creation to be the heirs of a heavenly hope, grant the fullness of your presence so that we may live in awe of your splendor, in devotion to your gospel, in love for your kingdom, and in longing for the coming of your Son Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing number 426.
Bless you.
First reading today comes from Psalm 146. The Psalms are the prayer book of the people of Israel. Some of them individual prayers, some of them collective prayers that the people said together at the temple. The nation of Israel was different from the nations around them. In other nations, their leaders were heralded as gods. Pharaoh was like a god. The nation of Israel said, no, we do not put our trust in flesh and blood, but in the eternal God. And this psalm reflects that today. Ultimately, leaders, human, come and go, kingdoms rise and fall, but God and God's kingdom endure forever. Amen. Praise the Lord. Aaron has this reading.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. Do not put your trust in princes, in mortals, in whom there is no help. When their breath departs, they return to the earth. On that very day, their plans perish. Happy are those who help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers. He upholds the orphan and the widow. But the way of the wicked he brings to ruin. The Lord will reign forever, your God, O Zion, for all generations. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Eternal God of our salvation, our rescue, our health, all things are yours. And when we bring hearts, hands, and voices to worship, we bring you what is yours. Yet so often we do not serve you as we ought, and the world is deeply torn by all the tensions and outright conflicts that come from worshiping something less than you. Our goodwill toward others often has no firm foundation and crumbles at the first tremor of real testing. In our personal affairs and in our larger judgments, we try to heal deep wounds with superficial cures. So, holy and loving God, forgive us. Confront us with your way of righting wrong, your strange and wondrous work of redemption through the sacrificial love of Jesus Christ, our Lord. We thank you that when we fail, we still can approach you through the work of Jesus and in your grace and forgiveness. And so we come again this day for that. Having confessed that we are not all you have destined us to be, we also come on behalf of those we care about and love. We are related to them in a variety of ways. Could be family, it could be through work or school. It could be a neighbor, it could be a fellow attendee, member of this church. You have knitted us together to be your people. And so when one suffers, we all do. And so we bring them before you now by name, and trusting them into your care. Hear now the names of those people.
Tracy, Laura, Kelly, and John.
Laura, Chelsea, Rosemary, and Brian.
Okay. Dory, Jeanette.
Molly, Caitlin.
Sydney, Ernie. Barbara. Okay.
John,
Jim.
Patrick and Dory.
James,
Jim,
Kathleen,
Nancy, Michelle,
Charlotte,
Karen, and Susan.
Now we'll bring our voices together as one as we pray as Jesus taught us, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven,
richly in so many ways. With the confidence that you are a providential and good God, who gives us each day our daily bread, we entrust into your care these gifts, knowing that when tomorrow comes and the day after, you will provide richly in those days as well. We do this not only to support the ministry of this church, but also to express our gratitude and your blessings and our confidence in you and what lies ahead. Thank you for your goodness to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Please be seated. We often think of religion as instruction about things we are supposed to do. And then you find out when you look at other religions that most of us of different religions have same moral codes and systems. What differs is the description of what the world is and how the world works. The biblical worldview is that God brought all things into being and sustains all creation. That which goes from God and flees and turns its own way, God seeks out by God's Spirit and redeems through Christ and brings back into fellowship. And that though our lives are mortal, that God does not let God's good creation go to naught. And God raises the dead. And we live in a world in which God is providing, and a world to come where we will be free from the cares of this world.
Amen.
A little description of the world we're talking about. Our passage today might lead you to believe that this Christian faith, as James sees it, is mostly do's and don'ts, things you're supposed to do. But it all starts out, this passage that Karen will read, with faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, who did not consider equality with God something to grasp. He emptied himself, became like us, and was obedient to God unto death, even death on a cross. Jesus has come and taken on all circumstances of the human race, and now we take on his immortality through faith. And that changes entirely the way we live. So, with that in mind, Karen will have our second reading for today, which will be the text for the sermon.
My brothers and sisters, do you, with your acts of favoritism, really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ? For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes also comes in, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothing and say, "Have a seat here, please," while the one who is poor, you say, "Stand there," or "Sit here at my feet," have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges and with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? You have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they that blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but falls in one point has become accountable for all of it. For the one who said, "You shall not commit adultery," also said, "You shall not commit murder." Now, if you do not commit adultery, but you do murder, you have become a transgressor of the whole law. So please, so speak, and so act as those who are to be judged by the law of the liberty. For judgment will be without mercy to anyone who has shown up mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith, but you do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, "Go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill," and you do nothing to supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead.
Amen.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Someone comes with good news. They proclaim the world is different from how your eyes perceive it. That there is a God who raises the dead. There is a God for whom all things are possible. And there is hope in this world, because the world has not been abandoned by God.
Amen.
And so we come every Sunday so that we do not abandon God and start to live in a world of despair, a world that's empty of the goodness and providence of God. I'm here to announce that today. Last month or so, every Sunday I go out and take a little walk before we leave for Worcester. Today I walked past an abandoned church building, a building that had been built by the English who came over into New Bedford when the textile mills were busy. And they wanted to have a church that was like the church they had in England. And so they set up this church. And now the building is abandoned. No church exists in it. And as I walked past, I looked to the top of the steeple where there was a cross. And sitting on the cross was a bird of prey, a hawk. And I was thinking how desolate one could take that. This church is now abandoned, and on the cross there is a bird who's searching for some other bird or animal to eat. What a desolate world we live in. And then I thought, that bird's life is limited. Jesus was raised from the dead, never to die again. And so we put our confidence in that. And God is not through with the world. And God is not through with you. And God is not through with me. And we believe that. And then we live in the world accordingly. Don't let appearances, don't let the naysayers lead you to believe that all is lost. That God is no longer active in this world. God is. And we are the people who display it and live it out day after day. We trust that God is still in this world. James is talking to a people who were getting stingy because they felt as though they lived in a finite world, hoarding their goods, looking out only for number one. And James, the pastor, has to say, look, we live in an abundant world where God is providing. Every good gift comes from above. Every perfect action of God is still active in the world. You do not have to look out only for number one, but care about other people too. Because this is not a scarce world. It is an abundant world where God is still active. And if you believe that, you will live that. And do that day after day. Trust and believe in this abundant God. And it will change your actions about how you treat other people.
Amen.
What kind of world do we see ourselves in? Desolate and abandoned, or one that is abundant, and one in which we can be generous? That's what James is directing us to today. What kind of world do we live in? The way you see the world is the way you will act in it. I think I told you once that I visited Uganda, visited three times. One time I was, and the guys with me were invited to a special dinner at a home for one of the local leaders of the village we were in. And we went to that home, we drove in the van, and as we approached the home, I noticed that there were a lot of neighbors gathering around outside. I thought they wanted to have a good look at us, these foreigners, these visitors who've come. So I figured, hey, here I am, sort of a local celebrity, my 15 minutes of fame, ta-da. And then we sat down and had the meal. And they put before me a nice plate of food. And so I cleaned my plate, because that's what you're supposed to do in this world, right? Then weren't you told by your mother, like I was mine, there's starving people in Africa. Don't waste food, clean your plate. So that's what I did. My mother had basically instilled in my mind that we live in a scarce world, even though actually it was relatively abundant. It was scarce. Clean your plate, and so I did. And as soon as my plate was cleaned, another plate came, filled with food. And I thought, oh, I have to clean this one too, because that's the way the world works, Mom told me. And so I cleaned that plate as well, and I was so full when they brought the third plate, and I said, please, I can't eat anymore. And they said, well, that's okay, because that's the way it works here in Uganda, in our world. When we have guests, we continue to serve them food until they don't want any more food. And then what we do with the food they don't eat is we feed all the people who are outside, gathered around this house, waiting maybe for a morsel. And I thought, oh my goodness. If that's not an inverted view of the world. My mom told me it's scarce, clean your plate. And so I did, because they're starving people. Then I go to where the supposed starving people are, and they keep feeding me abundantly, only for me to discover that in eating abundantly, I was denying food to someone who needed it. What kind of world is this? I've got to try to figure this one out. Mom said it's this way. They're showing me it's that way. See, the way we understand the world we live in will shape our actions. What kind of world do we live in? The whole world is filled with the glory of God, the psalmist said. That's the kind of world we live in. And so we who are experiencing in a special way that abundance need not hoard it, look out only for ourselves, but say there are others who could use it as well. What kind of world do we live in? Some would say, oh, we all live in the same world, right? I'm in this place, you're in this place. No, actually, mentally, you might say, spiritually, we can live in very different worlds. Some live in a God-empty world, where you look out for number one, take care of yourself, watch your own back. If you have something, be stingy with it, and let the other person figure out what to do with his or her own life. It's God-empty. For others, it is a glory-filled world with the abundance and care of God. And so we can be generous and not hold back. What kind of world do you live in? The world that you live in, or you believe you are living in, will shape your behavior.
Hallelujah.
Now, none of us knew for sure that anybody else was going to come to church today. But we live in a world where generally we believe that others will be here, and so we act accordingly, and we came. Believe it or not, you believed that people were going to be here. You did not know for sure. And you acted accordingly. The way you believe the world is will shape the decisions you make and the actions you take. And so here we are, abundantly enjoying each other's company. James is not giving mere moral instruction to those people. He's telling them about how the world works. And because this is how the world works, this is how we operate in it. He invites people to live in this world of abundance and be generous in it. He's telling them the truth of how the world works. And the way you believe the world to be will shape the way you live in it. Now, it is, according to Google, 16,171 days since a girl named Gail said, "I do," to a boy named Doug. And believe it or not, it's true. Nearly every one of those 16,171 days, when I wake up, I look to see if she's still there. Because I don't know for sure, but I believe. And on 16,172, tomorrow, I'm going to look again. But I don't know for sure she will be there. And I don't know if I'm going to be here. Maybe now is my time when God says you've had enough. But I believe, and so I live in that world confidently. And Gail and I can make plans for the week ahead. We act according to the world we believe we're in. Folks, believe it. We live in a world where God has not abandoned us.
Amen.
And God is still at work. Never mind those abandoned church buildings with birds of prey sitting up on the cross. God's kingdom endures forever, and we can live accordingly. James was one interesting, wonderful character in the Bible. James that we're talking about is believed to be the younger brother of Jesus Christ. He grew up with Jesus. And then he became a leader in the church when Jesus ascended. James is saying, believe in this wonderful world and live in God's world accordingly. It wasn't just a morality system, be nice to other people, that got James killed. He was martyred, like most of them were. It was because he refused not to assert the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. He would not renounce. He kept true to the end. He was considered one of the finest men in Jerusalem. A lot of the leaders in Jerusalem thought Jesus would come and go. We killed him, didn't we? He's off the scene. Now we can get back to business as usual. But business as usual did not come back. Because the world had changed because God had raised Jesus.
Amen.
And sent the Spirit. And God was active in the world. And James was leading this group of people. And he was known in Jerusalem as a righteous and just man, revered by all. But they wanted to do him in as well, because this whole Jesus thing had not left when they thought it would. And so they took James to the top of the temple. And they said, "James, you can save your life if you simply from the top of the temple proclaim in a loud voice that I was mistaken. No, this Jesus doesn't matter anymore, and all will be well." And so James went to the top of the temple. But instead of saying that, what they wanted him to say, he proclaimed the glory of God and the risen Jesus Christ, and that he would not bow a knee to anyone else. And they had enough, and so they threw him off the temple. And when he struck the ground, he was still not dead, so they stoned him. And that didn't seem to get the job done, so they beat him over the head with clubs. Not because of his morality system. It was very similar to the Jewish morality system. But because he said, this world is not the way you think it is. that there is a God who raises the dead and is still active in people's lives. He takes the broken and makes them whole. He takes the person who is lost and finds them and gives them new hope and life. He takes the person who thinks all is lost for me and forgives and mends them and makes them well and gives them new hope and a new purpose in the world. This God is still active. And James was not about to say anything less. And so he announces to his congregation, as I hope I am today, that we can live in this world with a new perspective of confidence, because God is still active in the world.
Amen.
Every Sunday we sing, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow." I don't ever recall saying, "Praise God from whom maybe one or two blessings flow." There is this God who is active in our lives day after day, and we rejoice and sing it out loud and praise. God is still on the scene. We need not be selfish hoarders. We can care for people knowing that God will care for us and for them. Not just lip service, but acting on the belief we have in a good and active God. Oh, James says, don't just give something, just don't see the person who needs a clothing or whatever and say, "Oh, be warm, blessings to you." But do something, because this is an abundant world, and act on the faith and belief you have in this world. In a God who raises the dead, the whole earth is filled with the glory of God. The world we live in and believe in will make a difference. When Jesus came to his hometown of Nazareth, they didn't believe in him. They didn't believe he could do anything at all. They said, "Isn't this just the carpenter's son?" La-dee-da. They lived in a world with no miracle. They didn't believe that God is active and that Jesus is the actor on God's behalf. And so in this lifeless, miracle-less world, Jesus could do no miracles. That's the world they live in. The world that you believe in will materialize and come to be. And it will change your perspective and your actions. On that first Easter, when Jesus was raised from the dead, a couple of his disciples thought all was lost. This is the one who we thought was going to redeem all of Israel. We had put our hopes in him, and now they have killed him. These two said to a walker who was beside them as they walked back on the road to Emmaus. They didn't recognize the person who was with them. Later on, their eyes were opened in the breaking of the bread. And they said, "The Lord is risen." And they ran back to Jerusalem to proclaim, "We have seen the Lord. The world is not what we thought it was. God is still active. He has raised Jesus from the dead. And we will go out and proclaim this. This God who makes all things new continues to be active, and we can live in this reality by faith." And so they went out to all the world to proclaim that the world is not the way people thought it was. They didn't go out to proclaim a morality system. They came to say, "There's good news. The world is different from what you thought. God is still active, and now you can act in this world in a new way." Hallelujah. The risen Jesus appeared to James as one of the first people he appeared to. They say that James was a resistant and resentful younger brother of Jesus. He was not considered so glorious as Jesus was to other people. James was not among the believers until Jesus appears to him after crucifixion. And now, not just his view of Jesus had changed, but his whole view of the world in which God is active. And so when they tell him to renounce, he says, "How can I go against what I know and believe to be true?" And so he acted accordingly, and he was martyred for faith in Christ and in a good God. Not for a morality system, a do's and don'ts. "Well, you really oughta and should do this." No, because he saw the world differently. One of the proofs of the resurrection of Jesus to his disciples is that they went out and gave their lives. They were scorned, maligned, beaten, stoned. And who would do that for just a morality system? You do it because the world is different and people need to know it. One of the first martyrs whose writings remain, the first they say that is from a Christian woman, was from a young lady named Perpetua, Lydia Perpetua. She lived in northern Africa around the year 200. She had just given birth to a child, and she was one who gave her life to Jesus Christ. But that was not okay in those times, because there was an emperor in Rome named Septimius Severus who said, "This is my world. I am the emperor. No one can swear allegiance to anyone but me." And she said, "Well, I swear allegiance to Jesus Christ, and I will not renounce him at any cost." And so she was imprisoned with her little baby. Her dad came and pleaded with her, "What's the difference? Just go along with it and say Septimius Severus is the great Lord of all the world." And she said, "I cannot do that, for I am a Christian." She pointed to a water pot and said, "Father, what do you call that?" He said, "A water pot." She said, would you call it by any other name? He said, "Of course not. It's a water pot." She says, "And so too, I am Christian, and I will not be called by any other name. I do not live in Septimius Severus's world. I live in the world of Jesus Christ." And so she was martyred, fed in the Colosseum to hungry beasts. But she remained steadfastly in the kingdom of God, not in the kingdom of any emperor, because that's how she saw the world. Kierkegaard said, "When the tyrant dies, his reign is over. When the martyr dies, her reign has only begun." That's the kind of God we live in. James says, "So count it all joy when you face trials, for this will purify your faith."
Amen.
"And support one another in it, because God raises the dead and brings into being things that are not." So if there's one thing that we can take from this, is what is needed now in this time, when birds of prey rest on crosses, when people feel as though the world is empty, it is to say, no, it's not. And this world is not all that is. There's something more.
Hallelujah.
There is a God who is active and who does not let death have the last word.
Amen.
That's what is needed in our time right now. Doing good things is fine. I applaud the group of people who came up with the saying, we got to be about more than food. We must be about spiritual nourishment and vitality. And the time has come for that. Yes, James says, do good things. But you can do good things because you're spiritually alive, because God is still active. And don't you forget it.
Amen.
This God brings back the lost and makes them found. He raises the dead and makes the broken whole. This is a God who's still active and can be for you and the people you know. And so it changes the way we live our lives based on the world in which we find ourselves. My father-in-law for several years was a director on the board of Liberty Mutual. And they would get together as a board once a year at what was called the Legends of Golf, Liberty Mutual Legends of Golf. And these businessmen, which my father-in-law was, would have an opportunity to rub shoulders with some of the professional golfers of the day. And he said, you know, there's a big difference between an amateur and a professional. He got to meet Chichi Rodriguez and play golf with him. There was a man named Julius Boros, who he met and played golf with. He said, Julius Boros one day got all of these businessmen out on the golf course, and instead of patting them on the back, he said to them, "You will never be professionals because you are amateurs. Because the world you live in is at a desk in an office. And maybe you go out on the weekends and dabble a little bit in golf, and you think that you can be a golfer. I'm here to tell you, you can't. Because if you're a professional, you don't live in an office. That's not your world. You go to the golf course every day and hit 1,000 shots or more. Your whole perspective is different because you're a professional and you live in a different world, and so you act accordingly. And I've thought about that, what my father-in-law says. Are we professional Christians, where that is our primary identity? Or are we just kind of amateurs who dabble a little bit on the weekends, but otherwise not so much? James says to those people, purify your hearts, you double-minded. Become single-minded. An amateur gives up when the task is unpleasant. The pro keeps showing up and keeping it up. The pro will go out and not trust completely in him or herself. Because anybody who's been doing it any amount of time, and Annie is a professional musician, and I'm sure as a professional she would say, you've come to learn that you can do, but every once in a while you realize you can't, but somehow unseen forces come to your aid and help you get it done. The professional trusts in something more than him or herself. There is this benevolent force in the world, and the professional knows it. The amateur says, well, it's a little hard, I give up, I'm done. I can't do it. The professional says, maybe I can, but somehow I've learned from experience that something will aid me and help me.
Amen.
That's what living in God's world is like. An amateur is like the addict who says, oh, I can quit any time, I just don't want to. Right? Oh, sure. Professional says, I don't want to be that person anymore. And what happens then is these unseen forces come to his or her aid. A higher power than themselves. That's the kind of world we live in. And it changes how we live in it. James says every good gift is from above. It comes down from God.
Amen.
It's not about you, it's about God. Thanks be to God. And that is our hope. Well, the people in James' churches were amateurs and needed to turn pro. They did not believe in a God from whom all blessings flow, and they needed to be told. They were getting stingy. They were dazzled by gold rings, not so much by God. They figured that maybe these wealthy people would benefit them rather than trusting in God's provision. That is a wrong view of the world, and James needed to write it.
Hallelujah.
No longer be partial and double-minded. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Live in a world in which God is active, and it will change your actions as well. If the world is empty and it's only our actions, will wear out. You will need either applause regularly or you will become resentful. You will feel if you give, you lose, never to get back again, because that's the world you live in. But if you believe that you give and God keeps giving, you can give to other people as well. Because the world is filled with God's activity. The flow is continuous. The blessings continue to flow. And so, folks, this world is filled with God's activity. The whole earth is filled with the glory of God, from whom all blessings flow. And live in this world with confidence in a professional way, and you too will be the people of God. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Come to the sacred table today not because you must, but because you may. Come to testify not that you are righteous, but that you sincerely love our Lord Jesus Christ and desire to be his true disciples. Come not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Not because you have any claim on the grace of God, but because in your frailty and sin you stand in constant need of God's mercy and help. Come not to express your opinion, but to seek the presence of Christ and to pray for his Spirit. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God our thanks and praise.
The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, blessed forever, to you be praise and honor for giving yourself, shedding your blood, and letting your body be broken in death for our sake, so that we might have the forgiveness of sins and eternal life. Bless, O God, this bread which we together eat and the cup which we together drink. Let us, through this blessed bread and this blessed cup, become partakers of our Savior Jesus Christ. Unite us with one another and with all your people in heaven and on earth. Consecrate us, body and soul, to be a living, acceptable offering to you, so that in word and deed we may continually praise and glorify your holy name, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
The bread which we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. And the cup which we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? We have gifts from God for us, the people of God. Receive them today with grateful hearts. Will the servers come forward at this time, please?
Thank you.
who, having witnessed to you on earth, now live with you in heaven. Each of us has someone special who is waiting for us and whose reunion we look forward to. So keep us in fellowship with them until we meet all the faithful in the joy of your kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Karen.
Okay, announcements. Anyone who wants to support our ministries, we're welcome to give a donation, either through PayPal or using the QR code, or dropping it off, mailing it to 25 Francis Street here in Worcester, 01606. Today is Homecoming Sunday, everybody, and so we have a special breakfast following this service, so please plan to stay a few minutes and partake, because they have some wonderful, delicious food. That's going to be provided by the Special Projects Committee, who we thank.
Amen.
We need some help always, and the diaconate, the Sunday live streaming, the building maintenance, and coffee fellowship. If you are looking for something and you don't know what, come and see me as member of the stewardship committee. I'm happy to talk to you about other opportunities that may be available for you to partake. One of which has come up recently is the next slide, where we need someone who would like to come in and help us by answering the phones, buzzing people in through the door, that type of thing, just for 1 or 2 days, possibly a month. So we're happy to get involved in that. The jewelry group is meeting this coming Saturday from 10 to 12. And is it in the conference room? In the conference room you're meeting? Or the... Fisher Hall. Okay, so Fisher Hall, meet there. And they're doing some creative things with jewelry so that they can sell it at the fair. So please come, and even if you haven't come before, you're welcome. The food pantry this week is Chef Boyardee, and next week is pasta. The breakfast program is ongoing following the service. Just before they have breakfast, they will be stuffing the bags and taking them up to distribute. So if you're able to help, please see Lynn Wazlewski. The altar flowers today are in memory of Merton Wilmont by the Trippi family.
Amen.
And we also have some new flowers in the garden room, memorial garden room, that are in memory of loved ones by Claude Loans.
Amen.
Coffee hour, as I said, is from the Special Projects. And anyone who's on the Stewardship Committee, I had planned to have a meeting today. It is not happening today because we have the breakfast. We'll try for next Sunday. Also, Diane Warren, during the Easter season this past year, she distributed these small wooden crosses to everyone. And she's noticed that there's some new people who may not have received one during that season. So if you are able or you wish to have one, please see Diane, who's in the choir. She's back here in blue.
Okay. Amen.
So please come and see her, or she will be roaming around during the coffee hour. So please see her and get a cross. They're lovely. Any other announcements that I may have missed? Okay. The next hymn, our final hymn for today, will be number 391, Will You Let Me Be Your Servant?
Yeah.
Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Amen. Amen.